Visible regularization.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Let's move on. When to use regularization? When to use gradient boost? Total internet. If you want, also there will not be any clarity for you. But however, I try to give my opinion. Gradient descent we discussed. Today we are going for regularization. This topic both are applicable for only prediction or linear regression. So this is what we wanted to discuss today. Yeah. Now, what is gradient descent? Already we discussed. Can you recap what we discussed that day? Gradient descent function is going to become like this. This is a gradient descent. What is this?
Yes.
Yeah. Then in the gradient descent, it would be the global minima would be like this. Not only this gradient descent function is not exactly the same for all the situation. It would be different also. See, like this also it will come. It will take a pattern based on the equation, the number of data set which is formed, how many variable involved based on that. In this case, one more point we need to be caution. This is local minima they used to call. This is global minima. Sometime algorithm will go and get stuck up with this and it will assume that it is local minima and it will exit. So it needs to go here, not here. It should lock and it should not take decision. This one concept that day I didn't tell. That's it. Now gradient
is... Your voice is a bit low.
Really?
Yes,
1 minute. I will try. Full. I may need to raise my voice. Is that okay now? Voice?
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I may need to be a bit louder. That is the only solution. If you couldn't hear. Is it a little bit okay or not?
Let me connect my Bluetooth, ma'am. Let's see.
Yeah. Shall I start? So this gradient descent, when we supposed to use, this is what your objective. You may reach that objective, may not. But gradient descent, when we supposed to use, is the discussion. Is it audible now? Girish, is it audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Full. Yeah, paka. Okay.
Fine. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, super, super. Yeah. Now, what we supposed to do when we need to use gradient descent is, whenever you will be calculating RMSE value should be near zero. In the original training itself, whenever you are doing training with this prediction or linear regression, you would be calculating RMSE. The moment RMSE is more, not zero, perhaps let us consider like this 0.8 or even 2 point something also. Why not? 2.8 also. RMSE value, the best RMSE value should be zero. The obtained RMSE after training would be 0.8 or it would be 2.8 also. We don't know. Then in that situation, how we can improve the model? The moment you talk about improving, you need to reduce RMSE. So this is 0.8. This is 2.8. Our objective is to move towards zero. That is the objective. In such situation, what is happening inside? Let us take for example, this is your experience. This is your salary component. Based on these two, we have 2 points. Let us say only two data points. Then based on two data points, some more you will draw a line. So initially, some line would be drawn, then immediately would be calculating RMSE value. This is how you are trying to do linear regression. So the RMSE value is too huge, more than 0.8, 2.8, 1.5. If it is too huge, that is danger. We need to reduce the RMSE value. For that, what they will be doing is they'll be trying to change the slope of the line in different verticals. See, I have altered the slope of the line here. Now for the newly drawn line, they will be calculating the RMSC. It become more. Whereas instead, I'm passing through like this. See, one of the, let me change the line. See, there are two points I have put. Here one point I have put, here one point. One point luckily lies on this line itself, where based on the slope where I started drawing the line, on that line, the point is lying. There is only one line. Now I calculate RMSC. Naturally, it will be lesser because only one point only creating error for it. Finding out this line is your objective. Finding out this line where the RMSC value is lesser. Finding out this line is done by gradient descent. Once again, I'll repeat. Imagine this is your experience. This is your salary. Salary versus experience. There are two points I'm getting. Originally, the line which I have obtained is like this. I'm calculating RMSC. This RMSC is more. I wanted to reduce the RMSC. So I'm trying different line. The line which I try, I'm doing like this slope. If I pass this, this is my second line. This is my first line. I'm trying to change the slope of the line. The moment I change the line, the slope is passing through this point. Only one point is distance. This is the square error or root mean square error, whatever. This ordinarily square error, OLS, anything you can call. Now, naturally, the error is reduced. Earlier, if you look at, this is the purple line, the very first line. Point is here. Here one point of error. Here one point of error. Two errors you have got. Naturally, error would go more. Now, we are trying in different slope, trying to change the line, alter the line. Because of the alteration, we are trying to get that determining slope of the new line where we can draw. That is determining slope only guided by this gradient descent. This gradient descent will guide us for which slope our RMSC is going to be reduced. So that model will be improved. Gradient descent is one of the model improving method or increasing accuracy or increasing prediction, whatever we call it, we can term it. So ultimate objective of gradient descent is to reduce RMSC in the original model by changing the slope and intercept. And it will try changing both slope and intercept. And it will find out the best fit line or good fit line so that RMSC will be reduced. The objective of gradient descent is to reduce RMSC value by finding out the best fit line suitable for the lesser RMSC value. This is the ultimate purpose of gradient descent. Is this clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, now we go, this is a kind of recap only I'm doing because we are going for regularization. When to use regularization is the next question. Now let us look at, it is other way around. It is opposite to what we discussed in gradient descent. Again, I am considering this is your experience. This is your salary component. Now, let us consider there are only two points. What is happening during training time is a strange field. Let us watch closely. The line is going through these two points exactly. This is called overfit. Exactly the line goes through the, passes through the line. So there is no error. Now, RMSC is zero. Now, the RMSC of your, this position is zero. Now, what is the danger by this situation? You said one use case, when the test data comes, may not match with this prediction. Test data would be absolutely different from the training data, the training circumstances, training situation. Then when test data arrives for this line, when the test data arrives, let us consider this is your test data. lot of error. The moment I am keeping away from this line, what is the meaning? Error. Everywhere this error is coming. Every point, error is induced. Total RMSE of test would be much more higher. Whereas RMSE of training test is zero. There is no error at all. It is drastic situation. It is like kind of what, when I conduct a test in the class, you will be getting 100 of 100. The moment you go to the examination, you will get zero also, or you will get 50 also, you will fail also. Something lesser mark you may get. So that, how to overcome this situation? Whenever overfitting happened during training time, overfitting, the moment the word we use overfitting, it is meant for training. Where while testing, it will be underfit. It will not fit at all. It is underfitting. See, all the green points are my test data. What is the pathetic situation? I am not able to do. This green is my test data. Green is test, whereas maroon is training data. The maroon is train data. Now, train data exactly fits with yellow line. Always there is a fight or error. Ordinary least square error or root mean square error, whatever. The distance between the yellow line and the green points are more. The more and more the distance, the cost involved is more. Otherwise, penalty is more, error is more. Hi. finally, she has come. Mm. The error is more. So, how we can reduce, how we can match the situation between testing and training is what our objective. In order to reduce the error during test time, the regularization is used, not during the training time. Gradient descent useful for both training time as well as testing time. Gradient descent helps for finding the best fit both for training and testing. The moment we use regularization, it's meant for testing time. Testing time reducing the RMSE only is what our objective. So what we are trying to do here, let us go for one more example. Let me erase this point. Sorry. Let me erase this. Once again, I'll draw. This is your experience. This is your salary. During test time, overfitting happened. During test time, overfitting happened. During training time, overfitting happened. During test time, that the green dots, something like this. How we can reduce the error? So that we may need to try. Now, what I'm trying to do, I'm changing the line. I'm not going to use this line during training time, whatever has come. I'm trying to change the line by changing the slope. Only the slope is changed or altered whenever we do regularization. Whereas during gradient descent, both slope and intercept both are changing. Now the moment we change the slope, whether it is reducing the error or not, we need to try. Similarly, we need to keep on iterating as much as possible the lines. For each and every line, how much the error is reduced. It is going to become like this. This is the game. It needs to tilt the line. Tilting or changing the slope of the line or altering the direction of the line. Whatever we want, we can think and imagine. Finally, the best fit line or goodness of it, so that the error need to be reduced. That is what our objective. It is applicable during testing time. Regularization is applicable during testing time. How we can reduce the error is what our objective. Training time, it became overfit. Testing time, how we can manage that situation suitable to the training, if not reducing the RMSE, is what our objective. That is called regularization. Now, I will show one animation. Before that, we will look at the equation. What is the equation is? Yi minus B naught minus summation of Dj Xij. This is the residual sum squares. This is how we will be calculating sum square error. Root mean square we used to discuss, no? This is how the root mean square is YA. The prediction value. You will have lot of information like this. your salary would be 20 rupees. Y variable, your salary would be 10 rupees, 5 rupees, 100 rupees, something like this. No, this is called YI. Every data point is called YI. During training, definitely you would be obtaining beta naught, coefficient, or slope, anything you can call it as. The equation is MX plus C. That M only, instead of M only, they are calling it as MX. The moment beta is introduced, in a multiple linear regression they used to call. How that multiple linear regression would come is beta naught X or only beta naught slope, then plus beta 1 X, then X1, then they will do beta 2 X2 and so on. This is how they will keep moving, writing the linear equation or multiple linear regression. Now, after training, you would be knowing what is your beta value. After training, you would be knowing what is your beta 1 value. After training, you would be knowing beta 2 value. That those coefficients only they are substituting. How many variables you are using, that many coefficients they are substituting. Then X is independent variable. You will have N independent variable. That is what they are trying to tell. I stands for which row, J stands for which column. You will have 1000 records, you will have 10 columns. So that row and column value is denoted by X and YA. That's it. Nothing more it is speaking about. So this root mean square error, that error, if you want to alter it, this lies with the line only. Which direction you are drawing, how you are drawing, that only going to speak about error between the points and the lines. This point, if you calculate error with respect to this line, it will be different. This point, if you calculate the error with respect to this line, would be different. If you calculate error with respect to and yet another line, would be different. This line, if you target, it would be like this. It would be like this. This is the imagination. Every line, how the OLS we are calculating, depending upon it, the RMSE value will be calculated. How you are connecting. So which line reduces the error, that line it will fix and come out. The algorithm will stop and terminate. Beyond that, we cannot do anything. So within that, it will keep rotating. It will try it out 10 trials or 20 trials. And finally, whichever the trial gives the best fit line, with that, it will come out. Now, let us see the formula. The same RSS we are going to use, this term is RSS, plus this is the only penalty component we are including. This is called penalty component. This penalty component is called regression. Ridge regression means, otherwise called it is L1 regression or L1 regularization. Ridge regression, L1 regularization, these are all the technical terminology. Both are interchangeably same. You can call it as ridge regression or L1 regularization. So both are same. So now this term which we are, penalty term which we are adding is called regression. Lambda, this lambda value you can isolate from 0 to any value. It cannot be infinite. It could be 50 or up to 10. The next is beta j. You need to consider square of each and every slope. Slope, you need to square it. This is what slope, whenever you are getting beta naught, coefficient or slope. If you are using three variable, you would be getting three coefficients after training. If you are using two variable, you would be getting two coefficient after training. If you are using five variable, you would be getting five coefficients after training. Those are all called slopes. That slope, we need to square it. That's it. This is the only term we are adding with the RSS, penalty term. J is equal to 1 to P. Number of parameters we can say, then followed by beta. Which parameter we are concentrating, that beta coefficient square. Then we are multiplying lambda. This lambda value we can start with 0 to maybe 10 also. If we start with 0, what is the meaning? Nothing. There is no ridge regression is happening at all. Only the RSS. Nothing we are doing with the ridge regression. We are not at all applying ridge regression. We are originally retaining the RSS. So there is no effect in it. So never it should be zero. Perhaps you can start with one lambda value. Maximum most of the people coders, they will start with one. because beta I itself, they will be changing, the slope they will keep on changing and keep on rotating, the beta I itself varying parameter, every time they will vary the beta I, original beta I will come. During the first iteration, first time execution, the entire equation would be getting some answer. Then through that answer, we keep on iterating. Then through that iteration, the slope we will be keep on changing. So they will keep sometime lambda as fixed, beta 1 at only varying. In the second iteration, they will keep changing lambda also into different value. You can even start with lambda 0.5. You can start with lambda 1. And you can start with lambda 1.5, 2, anything you can try with. So for that value, we will be trying the ridge regression. Ridge regression, again, it is useful for avoiding the overfitting during testing. Or it is useful for avoiding underfitting during testing. Other way around, if we say, if training time overfit happened, through ridge regression, we can fit the test data. Already training time overfit happened through, training time, it would be eradicated with this adding the penalty. We are adding some term with the original error. We are artificially trying to draw a line. Because of that artificial term or this penalty line, the line, we are obtaining a new slope, at least for this slope, whether we could reduce the RMSE value, we are trying out. If we are succeeded, yes, that's it, we can exit. This is how ridge regression works. Suppose after applying ridge regression, lasso regression, nothing is improved, then we need to change the model. With linear regression, nothing more we can do. We need to change other prediction model. Let us move to lasso regression. In this lasso regression, only the change in parameter is, we are going to take norm. Norm means like this. If it is minus, it will give positive. If it is positive also, it will give positive. That's it. Here we are doing square. Here we are doing norm, beta j. Lambda is fixed. Now the formula for lasso regression, otherwise called L2 regularization. Now the formula for lasso or L2 regularization is J is equal to 1 to P lambda. This lambda value, as I said previous, from 0 to 10, any value you can fix. Then it is going to calculate all of your coefficients BJ. The J oscillates from here only J is written. 1 to P, BJ norm. Norm means what? We are taking norm. The moment we put norm, irrespective of the number, whether it is positive or negative, the written value would become only the positive. Somehow we are trying to do one, look at most of the formula, we are worrying for only the negative. Negative and the positive cancellation happens, nothing you can predict, nothing you can take decision. Here they are taking care of through square, something x square. They are eradicating negatives. Through squaring, here they are eradicating negatives through norm function. That's it, nothing more they are doing. So only multiplicand of lambda plays a role in changing the slope. So through that, they are trying to avoid the error rate, RMSE or cost function. They are reducing the cost. This is otherwise called metrics for error prediction, otherwise called cost function. Cost or error prediction, both are said to be same. Cost means the expenditure, or never, always we will be worrying about reducing the cost. Whenever we buy something, cost we will be expecting to reduce. With the cheapest cost I bought, we will be telling to the people proudly how cheap the goods and services are. That is cost reduction. So interchangeably, either cost or error, both are same meaning, error reduction. We are trying to reduce the error. That error reduction or error itself calculated by RMSE in the linear regression, the best prediction for the hackathon people used to tell, bring error level near zero. Near zero value they will ask us to predict. 0.2, 0.1, 0.3. And that if you get, you will be winning in the hackathon. So this near zero value we may need to obtain. For that, we are trying to use, first one is gradient descent. Gradient descent, original algorithm itself, we are applying and we are trying to fit the best fit line, and we are trying to do during training itself, during both testing also. Whereas regularization, training time, the data became overfit. Exact fit happened. Whereas testing time, it was creating lot of error, or it produces lot of error. How that testing time we can reduce? For that only we are applying regularization. Within that regularization, there are two techniques. One is ridge regression, lasso regression, or L1 regression, regularization, or L2 regularization. The moment you go to deep learning, they don't use ridge regression, lasso regression. They will use the vocabulary only L1 regularization, L2 regularization. That reason I don't know. Both are interchangeably same. That's it. Now let us move to one of the animation. Let us watch this. See, linear degree polynomial 10th degree. It is trying to change the slope. All the circles are the data point. Every circle is a data point. So the best fit of the line for 3 degree polynomial, 10th degree polynomial, linear. All those things it is trying to do. Not only linear. Linear means only one simple variable. When we use multiple variable based on the data, the obtained coefficient, what is the value of beta naught, what is the value of beta 1, what is the value of beta 2, that all determines the shape of the line, the polynomial degree of the function. That function polynomial degree is different. See, this polynomial degree only a straight line. The moment a straight line comes, that is called linear. The moment this sinusoidal wave comes, it is third degree polynomial. The moment so many peaks and so many valleys, like this highly zigzag or oscillation, more oscillation, this comes, it is called higher degree polynomial, 10th degree polynomial. So whenever it goes to 10th degree polynomial, entire thing will work in n-dimensional data. So for our understanding, all the time, any expert, anybody will be explaining through linear only. They don't even touch upon any other polynomials. Yeah, this one animation only I wanted to show. See, all the three, they are showing into one thing, different degree polynomials. Yeah, we will go back to the material.
Whenever I see these formulas, I feel data science is not for me.
No need to worry. Some extent, see, if you are academician, it's your fate to understand everything because you are teaching. If you are working in industry, something you should know, your versatility should go towards only the Python code. Python code nowadays making so powerful. We no need to worry. The person who is sitting and developing that one line note, those people are taking care of these all formulas. We are free to worry. But whenever we learn something, we should know a little bit common sense. We should have when we need to use this, why we need to use this, what circumstance we need to use this, how to interpret the result, and why it is working out for this data, why it is not working out. That kind of inferential knowledge only required. No need to worry of the mathematics. Really, I say you for industrialist. When you are academician, it is your fate to explain something. See, what I can explain without this all, see, showing the Python code, one data set, half an hour over, then real learning will not happen. So some idea we should know why it is going on. Why we are learning academician. This is our duty, is to invent new formulas, new algorithms, new models. So you'll be sitting and thinking how this, ultimately what is the inner mechanism is going. Totally, they are trying to include penalty term in terms of multiplicative nature. In the multiplicative nature also, they don't want to cancel positive and negative. So is there any other formula to substitute here? So that because of a new invention, is anything will happen, miraculous things in the data science. The moment I bring one more formula instead of ridge regression, linear regression, overnight popularity I used to get. So for that reason, we the academicians, we do like this. Because we don't take data, we don't work on the data, we don't get any payment unless otherwise we do a consultancy to the company. So whereas we need to do research, applied research means like you guys, I can take any real-time data or UCI data, whatever Kaggle data, and I can do and I can publish a paper. Or else what we supposed to do, we'll be thinking on this kind of equations. What else we can do to keep guiding that SOAP oscillations? It's kind of oscillation we are doing, that's it. So for that, how I can propose a new formula? I need to validate, I need to verify, I need to prove how it is working. And I need to tell limitations, I need to tell advantages, how best it is, in what circumstances, like that. So for that, we need to study the solved formulas. That's the fate we are doing. Don't worry of anything. So Python code, but a little common sense we should have. What's happening inside, what kind of formula, why it is. Any presentation comes also, we can talk a little bit intelligent than other people.
Okay.
Yeah, no need to worry a lot of this. Or else, just go and watch Khan Academy, Statistics and Probability. I tell you, you are the best. Khan Academy, school level education only they are teaching, and that is meant for only school education. Or else, teach mathematics to 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th standard students. Take a tuition. Mathematics will start from 8th or 9th, then slowly every 6 months or 1 year you will be improved. And really I tell you, when I studied mathematics, I got 98 in 10th standard, plus 2 also 194. But those all faded away, forgotten. How I got a grip is, one 8th standard, one 9th standard, one 10th standard, plus 1 or plus 2, I don't know. So some 4-5 students I taught science and mathematics. So daily I used to sit and struggle how to teach them, how to solve them that. So because of that situation, little bit I am improved with that mathematics. That helps me during this data science teaching. If really you are passionate about mathematics, otherwise not required. But
no, ma'am, no.
But you should know what's happening inside, little bit. So this much knowledge is enough. Daily you are going through what I am trying to tell, no? What kind of formulas are there? What is the inner mechanism? Whether this works on probability or works on statistics or both. This kind of little insight is more than enough. So that will guide us to understand the nature of data. Slowly your innate, your own intelligence will guide you, intellect will guide you. Yeah.
Now, the point is what? See, we are talking about two very, you know, regularization techniques here. One is L1 and L2, right? So if someone come and ask me, you just tell me the next stop point, what you are adding in between. What is the difference between those two? Because both are regularization, both are, we are, you know, playing and testing data. Everything is fine. Everything is correct. If someone comes and asks me to explain, right, that remembering that mathematical formula, then like, you know, remembering the technical terms in terms of that beta, then lambda, then formation and all, right, that takes time.
Definitely. Other way around, what I can say is you teach data science to someone, either for free of cost or for with charging. That you will give a lot of transmission to you.
That's true. That is
another. Yeah.
Teaching is not at all easy.
Yeah, that a lot of thought process should go for articulation than even understanding. So that one will help. Now, another technique, both are applied in the same data set, the same, that is L1 and L2, both are attempted in the same illustration, same algorithm. That is called elastic net. We will use, we will come to know this all technique when we are doing Python code. People used to talk very casually, applied L1 regularization, L2 regularization, applied elastic net also. That time we should be aware, both of the regularization applied on it, that terms to be elastic net. After attending my session, you just casually keep watching any top 2-3 videos on any topic. Naturally, you will be falling into the topic. You will dip a lot. Nothing to worry.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, next we are going for, regularization is a must-know technique that you will nearly apply in all of your machine learning problem. Applying regularization is a default setting in all algorithms provided by SK Kittel Learn Library. most of the library SK SkyKit learn, it has by inbuilt itself so we no need to do artificially one regularization. The moment you fit a linear regression, that you are writing a command in Python, no, that linear regression itself sometime will take care. Then immediately you will be using the word fitter. All the time you will be mentioning the name of the model, whether it is classification or it is a regression, you will be mentioning the name of the model. Immediately you will use the line fitter. That fit will take care of this kind of fitter. We no need to worry. Already it is doing certain fitting mechanism inside that. That's what they are trying to tell. So we no need to go and do bits and pieces, sir. We may need to understand training time RMSC, testing time RMSC, lot of differences are there. We need to take decision where I need to use, what model I need to use. That is where our intelligence, data science intelligence. For that, we are going to look at some notebook. No need to worry. This one of the animation, it is useful for neural network. If you wish, I can show. Otherwise, we move on. Okay, this is called...
See, ma'am, let us see.
Yeah, okay. Popular playground for TensorFlow. Anybody starts learning deep learning, people will be going craze of this one. This is the, all the link I had given in my material. So whenever you are free, you can just go through. Now I'll just play this link. Yeah, this is initial. Epoch in terms of deep learning, number of iterations, cycle, doing the job again and again, that is epoch. You may be taking a round in the playground. I tell that 10 round you need to go. Even that all the police, they will be given punishment there. Every day they need to go 5 rounds, 6 rounds within that time. Police training will be constant. One of my relative is a police officer, so she used to run that. How many times you need to run, I fix. That is called epoch. Here also epoch only. So here epoch, we no need to worry of epoch. See, before playing, we need to fix. The game is learning rate is too slow, 0.001. If the learning rate is too slow, slow learning will happen. Learning will be too much time it would take. Whereas the learning, if you fix 10, fast learning will happen. Sometime the accuracy you may miss out. Always fixing the learning rate should be nominal. Learning rate, probably this is the best. 0.01, 0.001, these two are the best. Very rare case, 0.1. So let's fix any one of the learning rate. Activation function. Here every layer, how many neurons you need to keep, how many layers you need to keep, in each layer, which activation function. Activation function means, what is a value should come out of that layer. I'm giving you something, how you manipulate that. For example, gossiping, when it happens in the film, they will be telling, now one lady will be going and telling about some gossiping about other lady to other, one more lady. She will pass on that message to other lady in different way. That it will keep on modulated. That kind is called activation here. Given the input to one layer, what you are getting out of that layer, that how you are taking activated TANH, ReLU, sigmoid, linear. So these are, there are so many nowadays, leaky ReLU, so many ReLU functions has come. But ReLU itself, people modified many versions. So ReLU. Then regularization. You have only two regularization in this playground. Third one is also there. That is elastic net. So either you can apply L1 regularization or L2 regularization. That is your choice. Then regularization rate. That lambda we are using the function. Na? Lambda summation. Some slope square. V0 square. That lambda value you are fixing here. What do you want to keep? 1.1, 0.3. What do you want? Then you need to choose which type, whether you want to do regression or you want to do classification. So that's it. Then you need to play. Then you can fix how many node. Here in this layer, I want 3 node, this node. Then ratio of training test data, how much you want, 70-30. Noise that you want to induce or not. Batch size, when it becomes big data, huge data you will be having. So what is the batch size you are fixing? So how the batches are supplied for the training and testing, that batch size. Once if these all are given, whether you want to reduce the neurons or increase the neurons in the layer, similarly here. So this is what your output. So you need to play. It will show you, look at loss calculation it is doing. Training loss, testing loss. If the loss comes nearby, it stops. Epoch. If you want, you can increase epoch, otherwise stop. So look at 0.119 point, I will use spotlight. 0.115, 0.119, very near. There is no big difference. Neither overfitting nor underfitting. It is the best fit, the best fit happened. Got the idea? After how many iteration? 202 iteration. It is too high. It should be lesser. Maybe it would have come. I didn't notice. Fraction of second it is going on. But the point. So these are all the parameters. Learning rate, activation layer, regularization rate, problem type, regression or classification. Then what is here? Noise, with the noise you want to do. What is the split of the data? 70-30 or 80-20. Then what is the batch size? Then number of neurons per layer. The number of layer we can't decide, I think so, or I don't know here. Yeah, you can give plus third layer also. Here layer also you can increase, and nodes per layer also you can increase or decrease. Finally, you can do, it will calculate the loss function, test loss and training loss. If the beam is very near, you can stop the game. So this is very interesting. All the famous artificial intelligence teachers, mandatory will introduce this website. This is called Playground. I have kept this also. Yeah. Let us move back to next. Bagging. Actually, bagging is the concept I have introduced already. We are going with more of conscious to understand the difference between bagging and bootstrapping. And one thing I want to tell, random forest is algorithm, ensemble algorithm, all the time it uses only decision tree. We need to be careful. This is only ensemble algorithm uses uniform model, multiple trees. Normally forest means what? Several trees constitute a forest that we know. So multiple trees are going to play a role in the random forest algorithm. All are of uniform or similar models are used. That is random forest. Bagging, what will happen? I tell you. You have freedom to use multiple models in a single. That is the only subtle difference between bagging and boosting. Got the idea? I will write once again. Bagging is the technique. We will split the data or we pack the data. We pack the data or we create buckets of data. All the buckets. For each bucket, you are free to use any data model. One bucket you will use SVM, another bucket you will use Naive Bayes, another bucket you will use logistic regression, another bucket, whatever you know, all fantasy will apply. That is bagging. Boosting. Pick the data, pack the data, each bucket you are expected to use the same algorithm or same model, that is decision tree. That model is called random forest. That is boosting. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now let us move to still more explanation. Not if you would have picked up this moment, I am done, no more job. If not, once again the same revision. See, n number of instances you have. Imagine 1 lakh records, 1 lakh rows. You have 1 lakh rows. Among that, randomly you are choosing 1,500 data, 60% training, 1,000 data you are moving to this bucket or bag. That is why it is called bagging. Bag. Imagine you are having bags, 10 bags. Then other 1,500 data or instances or rows or records are moved to another bag. Similarly, yet another bag. Now, what you are trying to do, each bag, you are free to use any model. Here you will be using, for this data you will apply SVM, for this data you will apply logistic regression, this data you will apply anything else. You can take mean and predict. That is called averaging method. The moment you use ensemble, these all all the written examination. Ensemble algorithm. I have shown this question also from NPTEL. One question I have shown. Ensemble algorithm. Final results are predicted either by voting method or by averaging method. Difference between voting and averaging is output is 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. Whatever the output comes from each and every model, if it is linear regression or anything, it would be, you need to go for voting. How many outputs are the highest prediction? After that testing time, you will drop the test data here. You will drop one test data here. You will drop one test data here. For this one test data, whatever each and every model says, among that which is very majority, and there are 100 people. Out of 100 people, 80 members are telling Grish is too good guy. Then naturally you should accept. 80 students are telling he is a very worst guy. Naturally you should accept. That is voting. Every model I am going to look at the data. Majority of the model, what it is saying, I need to declare that. That classification, yes or no, good or bad, excellent or poor, that kind of declaration is should do. Mean is what? Instead of taking mean, all the results I need to take average. That's it. That is called averaging. These two words they will be using. This all interpretation, these all mandatory we should know. How it is doing that part, we no need to worry. The moment we talk the word ensemble algorithm, we need to apply either bagging or boosting. Bagging is the very predominant step, or even boosting also. You need to bag. You have 1,000 chocolates. You need to distribute to 100 of your friends or 25 of your friends. You need to take randomly certain chocolates. You will be mixing 10 varieties of chocolates. You will not worry about it. You will randomly take some chocolate, but you will have some count. Uniformity you need to maintain. No, there can be little bit imbalance. 10 chocolate you may be giving more for me, for others you may be reducing 10 chocolate. That's fine. But finally you may create the bags. That bagging need to be done, then only you can think of boosting. That boosting, two-step, ensemble. You can apply same algorithm on all the bags, or you can apply different algorithm for all the each and every bag. There are two varieties of ensemble. The moment you apply same algorithm on all the bag, that is only decision tree is possible, random forest. By default, random forest is ensemble algorithm. It does the bagging. After bagging, it applies only the same algorithm, that is a decision tree algorithm, across all the bags. That is called boosting. When you apply different algorithm on a bag, that is called bagging. That's it. Now look at features are labeled. Logistic regression accuracy 60, support vector machine, decision tree, 60, 75, 70, 65, either you can go for voting or you can go for averaging. You are taking set of features, you are applying for one bag logistic regression, another bag support vector machine, another bag decision tree, then finally you are taking either average or voting. One more thing, hot dog, I don't know, digital, I don't know what it is, never again. Let us see test image. This is a de-learning concept, but it is applicable for here also. This is one input. Then what you are doing, learning algorithm, you are bagging the samples into three bags. One bag you are applying logistic regression, another bag you are applying support vector machine, another bag you are applying decision tree. This decision tree says it's a hot dog, support vector machine says hot dog, logistic regression says not hot dog. So finally voting would be what? Since two people says it's a hot dog, I'm taking a decision, it's also a hot dog. It's like that, I'm telling na, 80 members I'm approaching, everybody is telling Suma is good. Then I need to believe it, she is good. I'm approaching 70 people, they are telling Girish is good. I believe it, Girish is good. The moment anybody, that majority tries to say you are bad, she is bad either, then I need to believe that bad. That's it. This is voting. Why do you use ensemble model? Better accuracy, no error, or higher consistency, avoid overfitting. When one model, all the data you put, no, more and more data, learning will become better. See, if I give more information, the same topic, they keep on teaching you, regularization, daily, half an hour, whether you learn it or not, I will keep on teaching. What will happen? One time you will start singing like a song. Whether you understand or not, all the terminology would be very familiar. You will feel much more comfortable. Overfit will happen. So more information if I give you, more it will happen. Exact learning will happen. So that's where they are bringing this ensemble model. They are splitting it into bags. The moment I am hiding information for you little, I am appointing, even see all the corporates, how they function, no? They don't give you entire work for you. Never ever you will be learning anything fully when you are working corporate. They will put you in data analysis, other guy will be deploying, other guy will be streaming the data, other guy will be taking decision. So there are information. Yeah.
Grishi, don't lock. My video is not working today. You only curse that you thought I'll send coronavirus, right? Don't lock, I understand.
You both
are sorry.
Coronavirus conscious, I think so. Yeah.
You know, when I'm stopping the video and on the video, he's laughing. That's why I'm getting angry.
I think he's laughing but trying to hide all the time.
Yes, that's why.
Guys, okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Then it is useful, this ensemble algorithm, useful for reducing bias and variance. Actually, bias and variance only cause for both overfit also, underfit also. This is ancestor of overfitting and underfitting. Who is the father and mother of overfit and underfit is bias and variance. Now, when and where to use ensemble model? Single model, whenever overfits happens, we need to go for ensemble model. Results worth the extra training can be used for classification as well as regression. That's it. Aggregate bagging, we need to use all the time. Multiple models, we need to try. That is the best method. See, they are creating a bag as bags. They are putting the data into each and every bag. Then for each and every bag, you can use, you are freedom, you are having to use common model or you are having freedom to use different model. Then you either you go for voting or averaging. Again, you have freedom, either you can use for voting or you can use for averaging. That's it. So this
is always good to use bagging, is right? It's always good to use bagging.
Yeah, definitely. When larger the data, you need to go for bagging.
No, because we can get help of 3 to 4 models. That means we never go wrong. Because some model, we won't rely on some model that it never predicts something.
Exactly. Exactly. That's it. These are all the way to improve. there is one more method to improve your accuracy or deployment time, that is cross validation. What is cross validation? This already several times we discussed. Now formally I am going to tell. Cross validation is one of the technique to improve. It is a kind of resampling. Resampling means, see, you have a data, 10,000 data or 10,000 records you are having. We are telling to the function, split the data into 70%, 30%. When you split 70 is 30, what will happen? Naturally, bias will happen, no? I will be considering this 30% as testing, this 70% as a training, or whatever the manner, but only one mannerism only will be there. What we are trying to do through cross-validation is, we are trying to change the training data, we are trying to change the testing data. Given the 10,000 data, we are taking these fellow, this side, left side fellow as a training, right side fellow as a testing. Another iteration, we will be trying the left side fellow as a testing, right side fellow as training. Another time, what we will be trying is middle fellow, we will be treating as a training data. These two tail fellow, we will be treating as a testing data. Another iteration, what we will be doing, these two tail fellow we are treating as a train data, middle fellow we will be treating as a test data. We will be trying and changing all the sampling method so that all the error we compute, keeping this fellow as a trainer, that fellow as a tester, something, all those combination, if we come to know the data nature when it arises for testing also, within that possibility only will come. At least a 5-fold cross validation, 10-fold stratified cross validation, look cross validation, look we leave one out cross validation, something. These are so many, are there, nothing to worry. Among that, the very famous model is K-fold. What is K-fold is, look at this is entire data. One time, one iteration, one execution. Naturally, it will do. You no need to do. You need to use the code, the right code. That's it. This portion is treated as train data. This portion of the data is treated as test data. Next iteration, this fellow, both are going to become training data. This fellow, this fellow. This fellow will become test data. Next time, this block, five-fold, entire data, it will divide into five chunks. Every time, where the chunk is there, that chunk would be a test, remaining all would be training. So this time the chunk is sitting here. So this fellow would be testing data. These fellows are training data. This is training data. This is testing data. This is training. See, opposite. Where we started, opposite we are doing iteration. So when we try all these combinations, when the test data comes for examination, see what that plus two time, what people will be doing, every day they will make you, they will kill you to write a test. All the combinations question they will give you. One day they will give first to one unit, last day they will give you last chapter. They will train you like that. You will become ready for that. That is what happening with the cross validation. Is this okay? Cross validation? Clear? Yes. Yeah.
లక్ష్మి గారు వన్ సెకండ్.
యా సక్సెస్
నిజంగా అండి. తను నో 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 యాక్చువల్లీ కరెంట్ కూడా పోయింది చూడండి. ఈ రోజు తను నేను అనుకున్నాడు సంథింగ్ దట్స్ ఇట్.
వన్ మోర్ డే వి కనెక్ట్ ఆఫ్టర్ 1 వీక్ ఆర్ 10 డేస్ ఐ వాంటెడ్ టు కనెక్ట్ యు
ఆల్. పవర్ కూడా యాక్చువల్లీ ఐ యామ్ లాగిన్ ఫ్రమ్ దిస్ వన్ మొబైల్.
ఓకే
మామ్ ఈ ప్లీజ్ కంటిన్యూ గైస్. బేబీ ఆల్సో క్రై. ఓకే thank you
your recorded video. Bye bye, farewell. Bye baby. One more animation for cross validation. Already that figure itself would be enough for you, but even then you can try. See cross validation how it does. That green bar, that alone it reaches a test, remaining all training.
Okay,
that's it. How many fold you want to give? 7-fold, 5-fold, 3-fold, 10-fold, that is your choice. Which is chunk, how many chunks you are dividing, what is the chunk ratio you want to give it to test? What are all the other data you want to give it to train? That you need
then,
to.
Then that will reduce or that will reduce or increase our learning rate, no ma'am?
It will increase the learning rate.
Correct.
Yeah, learning rate will become reduce. Yeah, rate will become lesser. It will reduce the learning rate. Rate of learning will become slower.
If it is 7 or 8, 9, that means the more iterations that we are more providing to test.
Exactly, more iterations. This is leave one out. Leave one out. It will leave only one data. Remaining all data would be a training data. Got the point? I have 100 students in my class. 99 students I will be training. One person only I will be testing every time.
Okay.
The fashion which you treat train data and test data, the name would be different. That's it. Nothing more. Now let us go to the coding. Almost theory over, animations over. Let us go to the coding.
Okay.
See, Bon, this coding, we are talking about regularization and elastic net. Then suppose which data, which notebook I supposed to use? Linear regression or cross validation? Bagging, boosting, I'm not touching. Because all the algorithm, I demonstrated bagging and boosting to you.
Right.
Random forest and all. Today we are concentrating only on regularization. Then
that linear, is for linear regression.
Linear regression, yeah. These all for plotting. Then mean square error. All the matrices required for model selection and model validation. Model validation we are using. See, in the same notebook, I am giving you grid search CV, k-fold, random search CV, train split, all the combinations we are using. Sklearn model selection, Sklearn matrix, math, then reading the file, dropping unwanted columns. The here, never we are going to use 60%. Already the data is available in terms of train, test, sample submission, testing that Y value, all those things separated. The data availability is separate. For this practice only, I have brought and I wanted to show this notebook. This is not the first one which we discussed. This is different notebook, but it is a linear regression. So that how the different combinations of data set is given to you, you can handle that exposure you would be getting. Then unwanted column, replace, whatever, these are data cleaning. After data cleaning, what we are doing, little bit of feature engineering we are doing, likes, popularity. This is what we tried for hackathon. We have submitted for one of the hackathon this notebook. What my team, my student and myself, that hackathon notebook only I am bringing to you. Then replace, then normalization, log normalization, min-max normalization, two different normalization we tried. Then see, there is no split at all. QBPC, whatever is available, that is assigned to X train, X test, Y train, Y test. Multiple assignment. So never we use the train test split, because the data which they gave in the hackathon itself, they split it in different pieces they gave. Then next is pre-processing, robust scalar. There is one more standard scalar I had given in the notebook itself. This is different scalar, that is robust scalar. Using robust scalar, we are trying to transform the data. After transforming the data, immediately we are going for linear regression. In the linear regression, look at this, we are applying cross validation. Cross underscore val score. The highest or the best RMSE would be coming out. The best fit model among all the cross. If you wish, you can ask the function to give each and every cross validation, each and every fold. That is also possible. You can manually verify which fold, which answer you are getting. If not, if you give this coding, it will give you the best mean value. then you are taking mean of that. After mean, you are taking square root. Math dot square root. After square root, what you are doing? You are fitting that value. After fitting, you are predicting the RMSE. The RMSE of original data is 0.219. The RMSE.
Close to
zero. Yeah, original. This is mean MSE, close to zero, 0.2. If it is 0.1, it is much more better. If it is zero, you are the lucky. Next.
Forfeit.
Now, no, this would be for testing time. Testing time, we no need to use forfeit. We are lucky that we could able to predict. Training time, it happens forfeit. Now, ridge regression. Alpha value we are setting. Then model fit. Then train. Same like only it will look. Only the word ridge. That ridge here itself I used, see, from sklearn linear earlier advanced cell itself I used, so that no error. You can give there also, you can give from sklearn.linear model input ridge also you can give. Now here look at our pathetic situation. Train data is lesser, 0.04, much more lesser, look at during ridge, but it couldn't do for test.
Correct. It's 0.3.
Yeah, very worse than the original model. My original is much better. Before artificial surgery, changing my nose, what is my nose is much better than after surgery. After Sridevi, what happened? She changed her nose position. After that, she lost her appearance. It's like that. We are trying for cosmetic surgery using ridge regression. It couldn't happen. Lasso regression, same from sklearn linear model import lasso. Parameters, this all alpha, different learning rate. Alpha, wherever you are looking at, that is called learning rate. Then grid search CV also we are using lasso. We are mixing both lasso as well as grid search CV. Then after doing that also, look at what is happening for you. Training time, going good. Testing time, worse than the original. We got original 0.21. Then elastic net, applying both lasso and ridge together, it is working. Alpha, L1 ratio, after giving this all hyperparameter, we are getting, look at testing 0.34. It remains the same. Whatever the 0.34, all the three, it remains the same. Nothing more is changed. This is alpha value. This is not record. Which alpha we got this value that we want to see. Internally, what happened? We tried several alpha value. No? So this is alpha value. Just we are printing that alpha value. Nothing more. I need to delete this code. Not required. So this is the only line. So finally, what is the conclusion? After my cosmetic surgery, I lost my beauty. I would have lived better what the God had given the features. So it is like
if at all we would have not used that L1 and L2 or elastic, we may ended up getting, you know, 0.5 or 0.6, 0.8, right? In testing.
Yeah.
Correct. That we don't know.
That we don't know. We need to try it out because we can't, without trying, we can't take any judgment. So we thought of doing better, but it is not going better. So here 0.344 we got. But this is original data. But only K-fold validation is applied. The best fold, it is giving the best accuracy. But what is happening during the regression time, we are not able to achieve. It is going down. Actually, because of this, I wanted to show you with the improvement. I tried two CAT notebook evening after college hour. All are like this. So that why to take that notebook, my own notebook I can keep, I stopped it. So you can find on the internet, maybe after applying lasso and regression would have improved also. I'm not, I cannot assure for that. That's it. Is this okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. These all I will send you tomorrow. So what you wanted to do